Hello and welcome aboard. On today's flight we'll be going from Lisboa in Portugal to Ponta Delgada, which is located in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean. Ponta Delgada is the biggest city in the region of the Azores. The Azores is a group of 9 islands, about 1500 kilometers off the coast of Portugal. We are taking advantage of an open event. Santa Maria Flight Information Region is open for all kinds of traffic. I am not sure if this is a weekly event, but it pops up now and then. So if you like oceanic flights, exciting approaches and beautiful scenery, then I can warmly recommend this event. Since the islands are pretty close to the mainland, then you can do 2 legs in about 4 hours. Or if you like smaller planes, then you can always do island hopping between the islands. If this sounds interesting, then stay with me. I will talk you through the procedures that are in place here in Santa Maria. But before we get into it, I have a little disclaimer. This video is unfortunately without any ATC voice. I am flying online, but I am a very new content creator and still playing a little bit around with my equipment. And to be totally honest with you, I've accidentally turned off the sounds. But don't worry, I've done what I can to recreate the transmission between myself and ATC. I have hired some help, so you're not just going to hear me talking to myself. I have obviously only done this where it makes sense, but you get the point. But stay with me anyway, because this is not going to be boring. Far from it, actually. We are going to talk a lot about the Santa Maria airspace and the procedures, as I said before. Then we are going to fly an Lnav approach into Ponta Delgada. To be more specific, it's a non-precision approach. And the runway at Ponta Delgada is also to the shorter side, so this is surely going to be fun. Mixed up with a lot of traffic today, actually. So stay tuned. I have been setting up the aircraft here in the background. If you are interested in the full setup of the aircraft, then click the link up in the corner, which will take you to my full 737 tutorial. But before we ask our departure clearance, then let us look at the local procedures and the flight plan. What we are looking at here is the pilot's guide for the Santa Maria Flight Information Region. These kind of pilot guides are always a great place to start, since they contain a lot of great information. The event that we are flying today is kind of an open event, so unlike the previous events that I have uploaded here on YouTube, we don't have a fixed route that we have to fly, so we actually have to look at the flight planning ourselves. So let's take a look at it. And here we see our flight plan. Our first waypoint is Busen. After that we are going direct to Komut. Then direct to 38 North 020 West, and then direct to Bakun. So let us look at the map of the airspace. Here we can see the different waypoints along the borders of the different flight information regions. We can see here that Komut, that is our first, or that is our entry waypoint, and Bakun is where we end up before entering the Santa Maria TMA. The route that we saw before was generated by SimBrief, but as we can see here, it looks fine. But since our destination is in the middle of the Atlantic, then let us look at the procedures. As usual, we have to obtain an oceanic clearance, and in this particular airspace, we have to request that clearance at least 40 minutes prior to entering oceanic airspace. Except if the flight is departing from the Azores, which is not our case, or departing Madeira, or if the flight is already past 40 minutes when ATC becomes online. But this is of course not a factor for us today, because we are leaving Portugal, so we just have to have our oceanic clearance at least 40 minutes before we enter oceanic airspace. In other words, for us it's just a normal oceanic clearance. If we, for instance, were going the other way from Ponta Delgada and back to Portugal, then the clearance would be a three-step process, as it's written here. And the way that works is that with your departure clearance, you have to state your requested Mach number, your requested flight level, and your maximum acceptable flight level for the oceanic crossing. Then we would be issued a clearance to the requested level, but that is not all. We would then, as soon as possible, have to contact Santa Maria Radio on VHF or HF or data link to obtain an actual oceanic clearance. And there's another little twist. We'll have to monitor the local frequency at the same time, which means that we would have to tune the COM2 radio in order to make this work. And in this case, it's the pilot's responsibility to contact Santa Maria Radio, so do not expect to be handed off. The last thing to keep in mind is that, as in any other oceanic airspace, if the estimate is changing by 3 minutes or more, we have to call in with a revised estimate. If you have never flown Oceanic before and you have no clue what I'm talking about, then don't worry. Click the link up in the corner. It will take you to my Oceanic Basics Guide, where I explain all the basics. Then we'll build up the clearance and ask the clearance with live ATC. The last thing that I want to talk about before we head into the cockpit is that in this flight information region, you can actually ask the Oceanic clearance via data link, which is really cool. To my knowledge, it is actually the only flight information region that allows this, and it can be done via the hobby CPDLC system. I'm not going to go into detail of what that is, but if you are familiar with hobbies, ACARS or CPDLC, then I'd strongly recommend that you take a look at the YouTube guide here provided by the Portugal Virtual Air Traffic Control Center. It's a really great tutorial, and it's really cool to actually have a simulated CPDLC. This also allows to simulate a more accurate ADS-B and ADS-C, as I've been talking about in my previous videos. So that is a really nice addition to the realism in the simulation of this. But I will not be talking much more about CPDLC in this video. Maybe I'll someday in another video post a tutorial to how this is working. But for now, let us head back into the cockpit and get ready to depart. I will of course, like in my other Oceanic flight videos, be talking a lot more about the clearance when we get airborne, and then we will ask the clearance together when it's time. But for now, let us get our departure clearance.
Lisboa Control, good day, 2Jet 107, Boeing 738, stand 126, requesting clearance to Ponta Delgada, and we have Zulu on board.
2Jet 107, good day, cleared to destination Ponta Delgada via the Busan 2 Sierra departure, runway 21, squawk 7571.
Cleared to Ponta Delgada, Busan 2 Sierra departure, squawk 7571, 2Jet 107.
Readback correct, report ready.
We're report ready, 2Jet 107.
Okay, that was pretty easy. I'll just do the rest of the pre-flight and setting up of the aircraft. If you'd like to see the pre-flight, then let me know in the comments section. I'd gladly include it in my videos in the future. But for now, head over to my 737 beginners tutorial if you'd like to see how I set up the aircraft. Well, I will be back with you in a little bit, then we'll do a taxi briefing and we'll talk a little bit about performance. We are almost ready to go, but before we call for push, then let us look at some performance calculations and a taxi briefing. Here we are looking at VAS airplane toolbox, and that is of course our performance for the takeoff. The tool suggests a selected temperature of plus 34 degrees and a further derate of 22k. But today things is a little bit different. Unfortunately, I do not have a recording of the ATIS, but we got the information with the ATIS that we could expect a uniform departure. So what does that mean? This means that we can expect to depart from the uniform intersection. We have runway 21 here, which is the runway we'll be taking off from. And we have the uniform intersection here. That means that we need to redo our calculations. And this goes for every aircraft except heavy aircraft, of course. That kind of makes sense. So let's pull up another chart. On this chart here, we can see our takeoff run available. If we look up at the top here, runway 21, takeoff run available from position uniform. We have 2410 meters available, so we need to put that into the calculation. If we look at our current calculation, the calculated takeoff run is 2419 meters, which is 9 meters longer than the run that we have available. So what is TORA, or takeoff run available? It is basically the length of runway deemed available and suitable for a ground run of an airplane during takeoff. So how do we calculate this? We simply just put 2410 into the entry point takeoff run available, and then we hit calculate. Then the situation looks a little bit different. Now we have to go full toga, and now the takeoff run is 1978 meters. That is also a bit of a difference. We would not have been able to make it if we hadn't done this calculation. It is also stated in the ATIS that you have to notify ATC if you require full length, but this adds a little bit to the realism when you can follow these kind of rules, so to speak. So let's have a quick look at the taxi chart here. We are now parked at stand 126. So we'll likely be going to taxi via Romeo, then via uniform, and then to the uniform intersection up here. So that's pretty straightforward. Let's head back into the cockpit and call for push. Normally, if ATC asks you if you are able to do an intersection departure, it is not really that big of a difference as in the example I have just shown you, especially not if it's in an aircraft like the 737 and it's a fairly large airport, then it does normally not change your D-rate. But if you are ever presented with the option of an intersection departure, then you can easily replicate the steps that I have just shown you before, if you want to be certain that you can make the takeoff. If you are in a larger aircraft, especially if you have flown the 757, then this calculation is absolutely critical, because that aircraft sure needs some runway.
And to Jet 107, stand 126, request push and start. Thank you. Push and start approved, facing north, to Jet 107.
Ground to cockpit. Please show me where you want to go. Still connected and bypass Scenic circuit. Release parking brake.
Runway 21 cleared for takeoff to Jet 107. And so Jet 107 passing 1,900 feet. And Lisboa Control to Jet 107 passing 3,400 feet. Continue climb flight level 240 and direct Vatsim to Jet 107.
We are almost already late. Let's look at what time we are estimating our first waypoint, Komut. I've just spoken to air traffic control and he told us to wait until the next sector when we are transferred to the next controller, and then we have to ask him for a frequency change. So that gives us a little bit of time. Always bear in mind when you are flying Oceanic, you might not get a handoff to clearance delivery. You might have to ask yourself for a frequency change. In the bigger events, you will often be transferred, but with these smaller events like this one, it's more common that you will have to ask for frequency change yourself. Anyways, let us build up the clearance so it's ready when we are going to contact Santa Maria Radio. This is basically what our request is going to contain, so let us take it step by step. First of all, of course, the Oceanic entry point and the estimated time, which today is Komut, and we are estimating Komut at 1518 Zulu. Next is our requested back number and flight level at the Oceanic entry point. We are requesting Mach.76 and flight level 340. The next point here is our highest acceptable flight level that can be maintained at the Oceanic entry fix, and that will today be flight level 380. And then of course, if there are any other information that is deemed necessary by the pilot. And in our case today, there is not any information that I feel is important to tell the controller. We saw a little bit earlier how to get our Oceanic fix ETA by clicking the RTE data button while on the legs page. If you want to determine your maximum level for the crossing, then click on the cruise button and you get to the cruise page. And there you can see your current flight level, your optimal flight level, and your maximum flight level. This is of course depending on which aircraft you are flying. We have finally been transferred to the next controller and told to tell him our intentions.
And to Jet 107, request frequency change for Oceanic clearance. Frequency 127.9, and we'll report back to Jet 107. Thank you.
Finally, there is a gap between the transmissions. You are unfortunately not able to hear the transmissions today, but it has been awfully busy. So if you're looking at the clock and thinking, what the hell is this guy doing? Then I'm just trying not to step on another transmission. But before we contact Santa Maria Radio, then be sure to hit the like button if this video has been helpful. Hit the bell icon to be sure not to miss the next video. And if you enjoy long-haul flights and Oceanic flights, then be sure to subscribe to the channel to help me grow to make even more videos.
Santa Maria Radio, good day, to Jet 107, request Oceanic clearance. And to Jet 107, requesting Oceanic clearance to Punta Delgada, estimating Komut at time 1518 Zulu, Mach.76, requesting flight level 340, maximum flight level 380, to Jet 107.
Santa Maria clears to Jet 107 to Punta Delgada via Komut, 38 North, 020 West, Bakun then as filed from Komut, maintain flight level 340, Mach.76.
Clear to Punta Delgada, Komut 38 North, 20 West, and then Bakun, Mach.76, flight level 340, to Jet 107.
2107, read back correct, 132.070 for sail call check.
132.070 for sail call check. 2107. Thank you. Bye bye. And Santa Maria Radio, 2Jet107, request sail call check.
2Jet107, good day. Primary frequency will be 132.070, secondary 124.850. Sail call check coming up.
Cell call check OK. Primary 132.070, secondary 124.850, TwoJet 107.
TwoJet 107, correct. Report Komoot.
Next position report at Komoot. Should we return to domestic, TwoJet 107?
TwoJet 107, affirmative.
Roger that, thank you. Returning to domestic, TwoJet 107.
That went well. We have now successfully obtained our Oceanic clearance. I'm just going to check in with the domestic controller and let him know what's going on. Since nothing has changed, I'm just going to tell him that we have to maintain flight level 340 from Komoot. It's always important to report any flight level changes or any time restrictions to the local controller. In that case, he will be able to help us with adhering to those restrictions.
And Lisboa Control, TwoJet 107 is back with you, flight level 340 from Komoot.
And we were simply just told to continue. As you may have noticed, this example differs a little bit from the example in the pilot's briefing. In theory, Santa Maria Radio would have read back our clearance request and then we'd give him or her a readback correct. But I believe due to the massive amount of traffic today, then they chose to skip that step and simply just go ahead and issue the actual clearance. I hope this example is somewhat useful. I unfortunately had to edit a little bit of it because sometimes it is a little bit hard to hear what the other pilots are saying on HF simulation, and I was kind of stepped on a little bit by another aircraft, and I totally do not blame him because it can be really hard, especially if you are far away, that is also simulated. Then it can be hard to hear if someone is actually transmitting or what's actually going on. Then I kind of lost the track of my notes because I was stepped on, and I easily distract when that kind of stuff happens. So I had to ask ATC for a say again for one of the waypoints because I simply lost track of my notes, as I said. But that's totally fine, that can happen, and normally I would leave it in the video, but because I lack the voice from the ATC, I thought it does not really make sense to leave it in the video, so I simply just edit it out, but that is the explanation. But I hope it's useful anyways. Now we have just got some cruising to do. I will check back in when we are transferred and we have to report position Komoot.
Position report at Komoot on frequency 132.070, TwoJet 107, thank you, bye bye.
We have just been handed off, so I will go over to Santa Maria Radio and I will do a position report. That is just your good old position report, there's nothing special about the position reports in this airspace.
Santa Maria Radio, TwoJet 107 with position report. And TwoJet 107 reporting position Komoot at time 1518 Zulu, flight level 340. Next waypoint 38 North 020 West, estimating at time 1548 Zulu and Bakun thereafter. Read back correct, TwoJet 107. Squawk 7571 and Santa Maria on 132.150, TwoJet 107, thank you, bye bye.
We have now been transferred to radar, which means that we are under radar coverage and will not be needing to do any more position reports. But we have still got some miles to go. So I will let you sit back and enjoy the views, and I'll be back with you when it's time to talk about the approach. Then we'll do a little briefing and then we'll talk briefly about Lnav approaches. Enjoy the flight.
And to jet 107, request descent. Descent flight level 260 to jet 107.
Oh, we are about to initiate our descent. If you watch the time lapse, then you have also seen that we have been cleared directly to share mic 452, which is the initial approach fix for the RNP approach for runway 12, which is the active runway. This means that we will not be flying a star, so let us look at the approach. Before we look at the actual approach, then let us quick talk about what an Lnav approach is and what kind of approach we are flying today. Lnav stands for Area Navigation. To put it very simple, an Lnav approach is a GPS aid approach, and it is flown without the use or help of ground-based nav aids. Today we are flying an Lnav approach, aka GPS non-precision approach. There is many other Lnav approaches, but I'll not be getting into them today. We will only focus on the Lnav approach, as it is the one we are going to. So, an Lnav approach. It's called an Lnav approach because only lateral guidance is provided. There is no vertical guidance in this kind of approach. This means that after the initial approach fix, the pilot descends to the minimum descent altitude using the barometric altimeter while cross-checking with the chart, kind of like dead reckoning. You are cross-checking the distance to the runway and the altitude that you are supposed to be at. This of course depends on the level of sophistication of your aircraft. You can really use any autopilot mode that you wish. If you are in a sophisticated aircraft, then you could of course just use the FMS to create a glide path that you could follow, which means that you can use VNAV to get all the way down to the minimum descent altitude. A glide path is not the same as a glide slope. A glide slope is coming off a ground-based station that is sending out a signal that the aircraft can track all the way down to the runway. A glide path is entirely different. It is a path that is calculated by the flight management system and is entirely made up by the aircraft. Just to summarize, after the initial approach fix, we can fly the approach with any mode that we like. If we were, for instance, flying an Lnav VNAV approach, then we had to use VNAV. That is not the case today. But since we are in a very capable aircraft, then we will use VNAV all the way down to the minimum. Here we are looking at the RNP Zoom approach, runway 12. It is important to get the approach right, since there is both an RNP Zulu, Yankee, and X-ray approach, and as you can see, they are very different. We are not cleared for the approach yet, but since we are cleared direct to Sierra Mike 452, then I am almost 100% certain that we will get the RNP Zulu approach for runway 12. It is pretty straightforward. We just join the approach here via Sierra Mike 452 directly to Sierra Mike 454, which is an intermediate approach fix. Then we go directly to Sierra Mike 455, at which it is mandatory for us to be at 2200 feet. There the approach starts, which is just a 3 degrees descent down to our minimum of 880 feet, and from there we'll take over manually and land the aircraft. In case we go missed, then we turn right directly to Petut, climbing to 4500 feet and join the holding. Then we'll of course contact Ponta Delgada approach. Since it seems like there is a lot of traffic today, I'll just familiarize myself with the different holdings. The only published holding that makes sense is the 26 holding. The inbound course is 93 degrees. I've just turned the chart upside down, just to make it easier to visualize what way we are going to turn, since things can happen a bit fast and you can easily get confused. But here, if we are inbound on 093, then we are doing right turns. This might probably to some seem a little stupid, but sometimes you can get, as I said, you can get a bit disorientated And then it's an easy way, at least I think it's an easy way, to determine what way you are, or what direction you are holding, if you are doing left turns or right turns. At least now we are prepared, and we know what is coming if ATC asks us to hold at 2-6. Often when it's busy on the frequency, it happens that you are told to hold on a very short notice, and therefore it is very nice to be prepared. Well, I think we have a pretty good idea of what is going to happen, so let us hop back into the cockpit and see how this one goes.
Minimum clean speed to jet 107.
We have already been told to reduce to minimum clean speed, which is the minimum speed at which you can operate the aircraft without any extension of flaps. So I think it's pretty busy down there.
At CR Mike 452, hold as published, to jet 107. Roger that, at CR Mike 452, inbound on present course and right turns, to jet 107.
Okay, so we have to hold at Shear Mike 452. So we just click the hold button, then we line select Shear Mike 452, and it's actually already in there. It looks okay. 279er, that's fine, and right turns, that is already in there. So it's pretty easy, but on this page you can of course change the inbound course, the direction, or if you are holding on a radial. So it's very easy in this aircraft. Well, that seems more like it. I was just afraid that I had missed something. I didn't really notice a published hold at Shear Mike 452. But as I was talking about earlier, we are about 8 miles from Shear Mike 452, and we have to program the FMC to do the hold. You really have to know what buttons to push, because you ain't got much time to play around with it.
Right turn direct to Sierra Mike 452, cleared RNP, Zulu approach, runway 12, Twijet 107. One 60 knots or less, Twijet 107.
1,000 to go.
We have already been told to slow down to minimum approach speed. And 2200 is set and we are slowly descending. It's the mandatory altitude by Sierra Mike 455. If we have a quick look at the ground chart, the runway is to the shorter side. And the apron is all the way at the other end, so we will surely have to backtrack. And with all the other aircraft coming in, this is going to be a challenge. We'll just have to settle down when we get to the runway, if you know what I mean.
Tower on 118.3, Twijet 107. Punta Delgada Tower, good day, Twijet 107 on the RNP Zulu, runway 12. Copy that, Twijet 107.
We just got some traffic information and I expect late landing clearance. I've set our minimum descent altitude, 900 feet, which is just rounded up from the 880 feet. We do not need to arm the approach for this one, we'll just leave it in VNAV, but in theory, as I said earlier, you could do it in vertical speed mode or you can even do it manually. But we'll just follow the glide path that the FMC has calculated. During the editing of this video, I have actually hit my first tiny milestone, my first 10 subscribers. I'm really grateful that you guys find my videos useful. That is kind of the meaning of it all. So I want to thank you a lot for watching, and thanks to everyone who have left feedback, it's always nice. And then I want to remind you to hit the like button if you like this video, subscribe to the channel if you like this kind of content and want to see more of it, hit the bell icon to be notified when there's a new video out, and leave me a comment and tell me where we are going next time, or tell me if there's anything I can explain a little bit better, I'd be very happy to do so. Once again, thank you for watching.
Runway 12, clear to land, Twijet 107.
In real life, there's actually lights installed here at the coast to help identify the proximity to the coast during approach. but I don't believe that is modeled.
Feet stabilized, Mr. Birch, altitude set.
Approaching minimums. Minimums.
Backtrack 1-2 and vacate echo 2-107.
That was definitely to the harder side. I should probably have chosen the Ryanair livery for today. But since there is another aircraft on approach, I figured that I did not have time to float, so I didn't want to risk it. If you look at the TCAS, then you can actually see the other aircraft. And it does take a little time to backtrack.
Taxi stand Whiskey 11, 2-107. And to Jet 107, we are at the stand. Thank you for service and have a great evening. See you, bye-bye.
Once again, we have made it safely down to the ground. This has been such an amazing flight. I really enjoy flying in Portugal and Santa Maria. Really friendly and competent ATC. So I'm definitely going to attend to this kind of event again. And I can of course warmly recommend it. I have nothing left to say than thank you a lot for flying with me once again. And I really hope you want to join me next time. And at last, let us look at some replays.